Our next speaker is Mr. K. Srinivasan. Mr. K. Srinivasan is the Secretary of All India Congress Committee in charge of Telangana State. An alumnus of IIM Bangalore and NIT Kozhikode, Srinivasan is a former Indian Information Service officer. Srinivasan had served as an officer in special duty with Sri late K. Karunakaran Singh during 95-96 as Union Minister in the Narasimha Rao cabinet. It helped Srinivasan to develop good vibes with Rahul and Priyanka Gandhi. He has always been in good books of Congress first family while keeping a low profile. He was a founder vice chairman of Federation of Overseas Recruitment Association of India. Let us welcome Mr. Srinivasan.
Mr. Suresh Madhusudanan, who is hosting this program. Mr. Jnaneshwar Mule, member of the National Human Rights Commission and former Secretary Ministry of External Affairs. Mr. M.C. Luther, former Protector General of Immigrants. Mrs. Sita Sharma from ILO, Professor Irudai Rajan, and my colleagues from the industry. Mr. I'm talking here as strictly as a representative of the industry. So some of the points which I might raise here might appear to be one-sided, because now coming to the first point, which the industry is looking for from the government and which you have been raising for the last several years, is MRW, minimum referral wages. This minimum referral wages has been brought in by the government without any proper study, which the government itself has admitted in several of the meetings which we have held with the ministry during the last 4-5 years. They have been telling that we will be removing it at the earliest. We are trying to implement a law which we do not implement in our own country. Totally unrealistic salary figures are fixed for different categories. How do you expect the foreign governments to implement all those things? For the last several years, as Protector General of Immigrants, Mr. Luther himself is aware that there are two salary agreements, one for the immigrant system, one which is actually taking place. In certain cases, both are uploaded. Isn't 5 years not enough for the government of India to take a decision on this? You say quick decision, working government, functioning government. What is happening is in large companies which give decent salaries, because of this MRW, which unrealistic MRWs which have been fixed by the government, Indians are losing out. I don't know when they are going to take a decision on that. 5 years we have requested, and Mr. Luther, for the 3 years when he has been there, he has been telling that. Yes, several times he personally also, I can tell. He has agreed with us and he has said at the earliest this will be removed. Even to date is there. All ministers will say this is not realistic, but no decisions are taken. My father used to be a chairman of several banks. He used to say when some issues are there, the people used to go and meet the directors. All directors agree. But when the meeting, board meeting is held, the decision is not taken. Same thing is happening here. Now, Professor Irudai Rajan was just now mentioning about the re-migration. I'm sure this 5 lakh people, if they are coming to Kerala, you know the Kerala is at least 2 lakh will somehow go back, because they can't stay here for long. So when they go back, salaries will be renegotiated. So these sort of things should not become hurdles at that stage. Now, we know that even before this COVID issue came, employment was the biggest challenge this economy was facing. Now, when we are creating problems, the only request to the government is don't create hurdles. So please take a decision on that. I think I'm personally fed up of raising these issues again and again and again and again as a representative. Now, I think Professor Irudai Rajan should also listen to this. All countries give unemployment doles to those who do not have, those who have lost their employment or those who do not have a job. India is the only country in the world which will tax a person, unemployed person, when he gets a job. Now, he is paying a small charge, whatever it is, to the, including ticket to the ticketing, to the travel, to the recruiting agent. Why do you put a GST on that 18%? You are giving tax waivers of thousands of crores to large industrialists. Why do you, what is the logic of collecting a GST from an unemployed person from rural India? And even if you abolish the GST, the tax outgo or the revenue outgo for the government is a pittance. When you can write off thousands of crores for large industries. Why don't you give away a few crores to these unemployed youth of this country? It's a crime collecting tax from an unemployed person. I should say that. Now, as far as industry is concerned, as Professor Irudai Rajan and Professor and Mr. Luther had pointed out, see, it is not like we are exporting one product, one piece of mortar or one piece of machinery. We are giving an employment for an entire family, and the foreign exchange inflow into the country happens for the several years, in some cases for several decades. Continuous flow of foreign exchange. So why we are not treated as an export-oriented unit and given tax incentive? Even, you know, the funniest thing is, even when a foreign exchange remittance comes in, when some of the employers give the charges for recruitment, there also government says, okay, give us GST. The industry, see, the unique nature of our industry is that our product is employment, which is what the country needs to do. Our product is not a mortar or a car or a piece of cloth. Our product, the product of this industry is employment. So when we are into that employment, this thing, why no incentive is being given in spite of the repeated request to the government? I mean, no decisions are taken. I'm telling you, I should not, nobody should feel bad. But most of the, what happens is discussions are held, meetings are held, that no decisions are taken. We need quick decisions from the government of India in this situation. Now, the only place where quick decision is taken, when we send 1,000 candidates, one of them is sent back for some reason of his own, immediately we will start getting mail. One mail after another, Mithin from the ministry saying that please take action, please settle, please take action, please take action. Why can't you show 50% of that quickness in other areas also? Now, as many of the speakers have earlier pointed out, there is a bad name for the industry. Now, one thing which we understand with, as Protector General of Immigrants, Sri Luther will also agree with us. The number of candidates coming back or having issues, the number of candidates who go through registered recruitment agents, people having problem is less than 0.2% or 0.1%. This was not mentioned by me. This was mentioned by the then Minister of External Affairs, late Sushma Swaraji, in a meeting. But that 0.1 creates a problem. Had our product been some cashew, something you are, you export 1 ton, 0.10 kilograms come back, nobody bothers, nobody comes to know about it, we can rectify. But this 0.1% in the industry creates a problem. Now a situation has come, many people are coming back. Not because of the fault or wrong done by the industry, because of the prevailing situations. Salaries have been reduced, jobs have been terminated. These have been done with the legal backing of the local governments. Now, at least 10 or 15% of them are going to go to the local police stations or start sending mails to the government authorities saying, give back all our service charges. We cannot. We are spent on advertisement, we are spent on air ticket charges and so many other things. Now, this is the time for the survival of the industry. The government of India should give a blanket immunity to the industry, these sort of cases coming up. Because this is not our fault. This is an issue which the government of India or the Indian embassy should have taken up with the respective government. Now, salaries have been reduced legally by 50%. What has the embassy done? Now, if they come back and say, I lost my job or job was terminated, I went for 3 years, I worked only for 9 months, give me back all the charges, he will go to the local police stations. So the government of India should send, we had requested in the previous meeting which we had last week, the government of India should send a letter to all Director General of Police or to state government saying that police should not interfere in these cases. It will be handled directly by the ministry when they find that there is a genuine issue. So there we are looking for, the industry is looking for a blanket legal protection ministry for those people who are coming back to India because of COVID-related issues. Otherwise, the industry will sink. Now, all of us are facing major liquidity crunch. We are not different from micro, small and medium industries. They are talking about capital of up to 200 crores now they have enhanced. We are small industries. We are facing acute liquidity crunch. I'll give my own case. Last 3 months, I have given zero, nil returns GST. Nobody has gone. Who will go when the flights are? We have to give our salaries. We have to give our rentals. Now, you have taken from us, the government of India has taken us 50 lakh as bank guarantee In 99% of the cases, we are given 50 lakh cash FD and taken this bank guarantee. 99% of the cases. Now, if you look into the past history, not even 0.5% of this bank guarantee has ever in the last 30 years since 1988 encashed. Why do you want to hold such huge amounts? Reduce that to 20 lakhs. We are not asking for additional amount or something. Release that rest of the 30 lakhs so that it will give liquidity to the industry. Now, even if we get an order, how are we going to pump in money into the system? All of us have zero liquidity. So the government of India should consider releasing at least 30 lakhs of the bank guarantee. Again, I'm repeating, not even 1% of the bank guarantee has ever been used in the last 40 years, I should say, since 1983. Why do you want to hold it again and again? Look into the past history and take a decision in the light of what has happened over the years. And we are in need of, we are not asking the government to give 30 lakhs. Only thing what we are asking is, please release 30 lakhs. Instead of that, you come out with something new, an insurance policy or something like that. Now, all of us had big offices when we had a good business. In cities like Bombay, Cochin or Hyderabad, it's becoming extremely costly. 50% of us want to shift our offices. So we cannot wait for 5 or 6 months for the bureaucratic red tape to take its own time and take a decision. Please decentralize decision taking from Delhi. Let the local protector of immigrants give an in-principle permission to shift the offices, because we are not able to afford the rental. The industry is not able to afford the rental when there is only zero income. So please, the decision-making process in the ministry has to be quickened. Same is the case with license transfer. Many in the industry are 60 plus license holders. It's time has come that we cannot travel. Many of them cannot travel. 60 plus, they find it difficult because of the health reasons and because of innumerable restrictions to travel to the Middle East or to any foreign country. So arrangement should be given to transfer the license to the nominee at the earliest. Similarly, lapsed visas. Many visa, even in my case, there are around 70 or 80 visas have come. But before we could take the permission, quarantine and all these sorts have come, people have not been able to travel. Now, when we forward immigration clearance, there are so many issues. Issues will come where the visas have lapsed. So the government has to take a very liberal approach. Now, Professor, I'm quoting Professor Irudai Rajan. He said we should involve ourselves more in Skill India. How many times we have raised this issue? It is not the first time. We have raised several times the issue that Skill India should be implemented through the recruitment agents so that it will be much quicker, faster and more efficient way to send people abroad. They are skilled, they are trained, we can certify them, but no decision has been taken. The point that you raised is very, very right. The basic thing is that an attitudinal change has to be there, because we have to be seen as partners. We have to be seen as partners. One thing is very sure. Government can only be a regulator. Only private players like us can function in this industry and send people abroad. We have to go there, meet the client, work in a competitive environment, get orders, which the government is not supposed to do and the government cannot do. So please see the industry as our partners in generating employment in India. Now, as far as the Protector General of issue, Mr. Luther might also remember, even when Sushma Swaraji was there, I personally raised that issue. Protector General of Immigrants should be sitting in Saudi Arabia and Bahrain or Kuwait, not in Cochin, because the problems arise there. The migrants are there. We should be able to settle the issues there. In fact, as far as Indian embassy is concerned, I don't know, because I'm not criticizing or anything. We cannot give A plus grade to the work that has been done during the last several years, not now. When issues are there, when compared with the Philippines embassy or some other Sri Lankan embassy. So I think the post of protector of immigrants should be shifted from Cochin to Bahrain, from Mumbai to Riyadh, because these are all big countries. When they have an issue, how can they come back? There's no point. I think in this electronic era, there is no need to have branch offices. Just get onto the system, and one office in Delhi is more than enough. Rest the people should be in those countries so that they can raise up the problems. This is one thing we have been repeatedly asking. Now, there are several cases where the candidates are there. I think the flights should resume at the earliest. Otherwise, There will be some recruitments in those countries, no doubt about it. People should be able to go fast. Time is of essence. I think the flights, once the medical conditions improve, the flights should resume at the earliest. And you restrict charges of the recruitment agents. But all our input costs, there's no restriction. Air India or other airlines, when they charge normally sometimes 6,000, 7,000 or 8,000. When they say that the demand goes up, it goes up to 30,000. How will this work? Can the government of India give a ticket charge subsidy to the migrants? They are getting a job. Government does not have to, government does not have to invest anything else. Give subsidy to the tickets charges of immigrants who are going. Or keep a restriction of anything more than 8,000 rupees for a ticket. Government of India will subsidize. So that it will stop the loot of these airlines to a great extent. See, you have to restrict the cost at every point. Otherwise, they will find it difficult. Now, last point is, see, there are several issues in the post-COVID era will come up. Salaries will be reduced in countries abroad. Job security will not be very high. They might write an agreement for 3 years and the local governments might give a permission for 3 months, you can send them back. So I think the embassy should have a much bigger department of labor or to look after the issues of the overseas Indian workers in those countries. I think there also the government of India has to be more proactive. And last point, I fully agree with Professor Irudayarajan. It will take time to send people who are highly skilled. We have seen after 70 years of independence, the current state of affairs in India. Even if it is unskilled, I'm telling you, even if he gets 1,000 dirhams abroad, which is 20,000 rupees, engineers in this country are today willing to work for 10,000 rupees or less than that, graduate engineers. So if a labor, whether we call him by skilled or unskilled, whoever wants to go abroad, don't keep any restrictions. Let him go there and work in that environment. Daily wages in many parts of the country, I'm telling you, in some of the states where I also closely work, is 100 rupees in rural areas. So an unskilled worker who is earning 100 rupees in his village, if he or she, I would say, can earn 20,000 or 25,000 in those countries, let us not talk about MRW and other wishful things and restrict these people from going abroad. So to conclude, my main thing is, to the request to the government of India is, please be realistic. It is good to have long-term ambitions. Maybe 10 or 15 years it will take. But in the immediate future, where the immediate requirement is creating lakhs and millions of jobs, please be realistic and take quick decisions. Meetings are fine, but if decisions are not implemented, we also lose interest in the meetings. I'm telling you, this is what you should also know. All those who have participated in earlier meetings should array. We come there, have tea, pakoda, and go back. Nothing comes in. Most of the cases, I'm not saying always. At the higher level, decisions are not taken. After the meeting, you forget about it. That should not happen, sir, again. Because now we cannot afford that. Times have changed. As you said, times have changed. Quick decisions have to be taken. Realistic decisions have to be taken. Thank you so much for giving an opportunity to speak on behalf of the industry.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. You almost covered all the points what the recruitment industry is facing now.
Seagull International Human Resource Consultants. Bridging the gap between dream and reality.